maybe soon to be, potentially, the champ is joining us now. He's actually got some excellent tattoo work, as I can see from here.
He's wearing some ice, too.
He joins us now. Guy. He's blinged out. It is Sergio Pettis.
What's up, guys?
You can take the mask off here.
Sure,
we're vexed. Good. Look at this guy. How are you?
Doing well. How you doing?
Nice to see you, Sergio.
You too.
Let me see your black and gray work. Some of this is new, huh?
I've had it for a while.
Make sure you're talking to the mic.
I had it for a while.
Luke
now.
Is very critical of ink, so
I'm a big tattoo fan. I got some tattoos as well.
I was young when I got these ones, so I'm kind of itching for a new one.
Okay, good for you. Yeah. Hey, man, this is a huge fight for you.
Yes, sir.
They want you to move in here a little bit. Yeah. You got to be thrilled. Juan Archuleta. Here's the only issue with fighting Juan Archuleta, right? The dude has just unending cardio, does he not?
100%.
So, like, in terms of preparation for that, there's only, just do more work? What's the idea?
Just do more work. I feel like I put myself in a lot of uncomfortable positions for this fight. I did a lot of gauntlets, which is a fresh man every minute. So pretty much just getting beat up for like two rounds on top of already sparring four rounds prior to that. So just getting my cardio built up, getting used to that wear and tear. And, nothing new, man. It's just an extra two rounds. I fought a five-round fight before in Mexico City against Brandon
Elevation.
Moreno. Elevation was up there too. So I feel like I have a style that's very composed and calm, where I'm not exerting so much energy out there, not too emotional, just kind of letting myself be.
You know what's amazing? We were talking about this earlier today. We do another show. You left UFC, I think my math on this is right, when you were 25?
25 years old.
I mean, you're still a baby.
I'm actually 26.
26, yeah, okay, yeah. But the point being is, you know, at 27, MMA fans might have gotten a conception of you when you were 23, 24 in that space.
Yeah, yeah.
Dude, you're just a different guy at this point.
Oh, for sure. I was a baby fighting men at the time, so I feel like just going through the ups and downs of life as well. I had to figure out who I was, what not to do and what to do in the octagon and out of the octagon and just in the lifestyle of fighting. So I felt like that was all good preparation to lead me to this moment. 10 years later, this is my 10th year professional fighting this year.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's went by fast.
Well, yeah, it feels like he's been around forever.
Yeah.
Like, I cannot believe you're only 27 because your name had been there so early. You fought the best in the world at 125 pounds, basically going past the last decade. But I heard you call this fight, and rightfully so, a title fight headlining Bellator 258, the biggest of your career. As part of your evolution to now really being the best form of yourself, how much has dealing with pressure changed for you? And how much are you feeling that entering this fight?
You know what? I feel like I kind of got away from all that pressure. The fighting itself, you come in with a lot of pressure. You're fighting another guy who's trying to whoop your ass. And on top of that, it's those people around the road watching. And, being Anthony Pettis' little brother, that used to really affect me a lot when I was younger. But I feel like I, grew from that. I've learned a lot from that. And there's times where the pressure crushed me and I feel like now it's time, there's no more pressure, it's just time to shine and time to believe in myself, believe in the process, and just believe in my journey. Everything led me to this moment for a reason.
All right, Luke, over under, in either in his brother Anthony Pettis' house or the Pettis parents' house or wherever the home base is, over under on amount of Wheaties boxes that Anthony or the general family still owns.
Wow, that's a great question.
I'm gonna set that at, what do you got?
I wanna either go really crazy or kind of very modest. I'll go modest and say they've got 10 sitting around.
I was going to go minimum 500.
What do you got?
I don't got any, honestly. I probably ate all of them, honestly.
The mom doesn't have any?
I'm sure my mom does. She collects all this stuff. She probably has like one or two. She's not big into collecting too
much. Yeah, I imagine like a shelter room in the basement in case like a tornado comes just floor to ceiling.
We also just say at this point, I mean, it's fine. It was a major achievement when your brother got on it. Wheaties are gross.
Oh, yeah.
They're not that bad.
Yeah. Add a little sugar. You might change the game.
It's okay. Put a little Splenda on there. You're not doing too badly. But we're ranking cereals. You don't put Wheaties at the fucking top.
A wholesome Midwest woman, that's what you're calling them?
Yeah, it's a little bit of a Minnesota four. I mean, what are you going to do? Okay. One thing I was asking about your brother. First of all, how's he doing? I know that was a tough fight. He nearly pulled it out at the end, but didn't go his way. He's doing all right, though.
Yeah,
right?
He's doing okay. His body is recovering. It's the fight game, man. It's crazy. It's especially over there. They got a 17-day quarantine.
Great. I heard about that.
The preparation's a lot different, so he's got to get used to that. And also fighting in a new organization, I feel like that's different for Anthony. He's been with the UFC for so long.
Right.
Even when I came over to Bellator, I had to get used to things that just different. It's a lot different than what you're used to. So
I was going to ask you about that. To what extent did your brother say, because you went to Bellator first.
Yep.
He was still with UFC at the time. To what extent did he say, I want to go to the PFL just to have a different route than my brother? Like, did you guys talk about rejoining each other in Bellator and then decided against it? What happened there?
It was just an opportunity. PFL put up a great opportunity for Anthony, and he took it, He's done what he needed to do in the UFC. He's got a belt there. He's got a belt in the WEC. So being at the age he's at now, you know, I feel like he wanted a new journey and just try out things different, you know. And I feel like me going to Bellator kind of gave him that, like, okay, you know, it's okay to get out of the UFC and be just Anthony Pettis, you know, not a UFC fighter, but an MMA fighter.
Are you at all glad? Not that your brother's, you know, as you can imagine, I think it's fair to say he's probably closer to the end of his career than the beginning.
Yeah.
I don't think that's unfair. Are you glad? Not that that's happening per se, but what I mean to say is your brother's had a ton of shine, but, you know, he's sort of heading towards a little bit of the sunset of his career.
Yeah.
You're only 27 years old. Are you looking to, like, write chapters with your brother just not being, I'm not going to say not relevant, but this is just your own making. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, I really haven't put too much thought into that, honestly. Yeah, I'm not looking forward. I'm not a guy who thinks too far ahead or thinks about the past too much, and I'm really present in the moment. You know, it's something that I had to work on, and I feel like it made me happier as a person and as a fighter as well. So, yeah, man, I'm just focused on right now. This week, I'm focused on Juan Archuleta, and everything that happens else after this fight will happen, you know. Not in control of it.
Archuleta beat Patchy Mix for the vacant title. And, you know, we were wondering how Patchy's submission game would look against Archuleta. And even, you know, Juan had to fight out of a fairly precarious situation early. What did you learn about the champ in watching that you feel like, you know, maybe it can help you get the title here?
Yeah, I mean, Juan's a vet. You know, he's faced a lot of adversity in his career. He's fought Patricio Pitbull. You know, he's fought some big names. And he's 25-2. His record speaks for itself. You know, he's solid, man. He's a vet. He's going to be a tough fight. You know, it's going to be a war out there. But I feel like there's just some things that I do that he hasn't, you know, felt yet, you know, as far as just controlling the range. My footwork is very advanced, where I feel like I could definitely hit angles that will keep me away from that takedown or away from them big shots. I'm very good at not getting hit as well. So I feel like he's going to get frustrated with me, honestly, and it's going to bring him out of his game, and I could expose that.
When you went from 125 to 135, and you've been at 135 for some time now, not a huge jump, 10 pounds, but it still feels to me like there's a right way and a wrong way to do it.
Yeah.
What was the biggest lesson about going up 10 pounds for you?
Just how much happier I am at 135, honestly, man. You get to eat whatever, you know, not get to eat whatever. 125 was a blessing. It taught me so much that I needed to learn about discipline, about, you know, being strict. And for pretty much a whole month prior to that, like, my weight cut, I had to be like a monk, man. There's no room for error. You know, I had to be on point, so to make sure I made that weight. I was walking around pretty heavy at the time, too. You know, I'm a Mexican dude. I like tacos and burritos. And shit,
so. Who doesn't, dude?
Yeah,
who doesn't?
So I was walking around like 163, 165. So that's like a 40-pound cut on top of, you know, fighting some of the best in the world. And
Jesus, really?
Yeah, yeah. So it was.
What weight did you start the cut at?
For this fight? Or like,
no. For like any kind of 125
yeah,
fight?
Yeah, mostly 65, honestly. Yeah, yeah.
Damn,
yeah,
dude, that is crazy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I walked around around that.
I was going to ask you a food question because you're from Milwaukee, they can eat the shit out of things in that area.
Yeah, so I've heard.
Cheese and beer.
When you do let your hair down and get fat, when you do eat the kind of gas station cuisine that I do, in your area, what it's known for, what are you going after, man?
Oh, like, man, I'm going for, I like tacos, man. There's some good tacos over there. I'm a taco.
Okay, hold on, let's go through this. Here we go.
Yeah.
Do you get corn or do you get flour tortilla?
Corn.
Okay, do you get the double wrap or no?
I do.
Okay, so far so good.
Yeah, yeah.
Layer the taco for me.
Pastor or asada something like that with cilantro and onions. Keep it very, very simple.
A little cheese, maybe?
No, cheese. I'm not a cheese guy. A little avocado, a little hot sauce.
Okay.
Keep it traditional.
Yeah.
But I have been liking those birria tacos, the ones where you dip in the soup, and they're a little cheesy. So, yeah, I like those as well.
When you went to Mexico City, did you have the tacos there?
I had, I think it was called, like, Casa de Pastor or something. It was fire.
I've heard the tacos in Mexico City are, like, out of control.
Amazing. Yeah, I went hard after my fight out there.
I bet you did.
Had a sodium hangover.
What do they call those, the meats? Not the hot dog, but the damn, the kraut, the thing.
Sauerkraut?
No, the damn other meat, the other meat.
Carne asada?
Chorizo, carne asada.
Polish sausage.
It's chorizo, yeah, sausage.
Yeah,
right. Yep. All right, so here's still. Have you given any thought to, like, what a good age will be when you no longer want to do this? Because the interesting part about you is you're still so, I mean, this 27 is prime for you. But you did start earlier. So that tends to mean you probably will finish a little bit quicker. Have you thought about that?
Honestly, I haven't. I feel like the older I got, the more I fell in love with the sport, honestly. And the more, you know, my lifestyle was so different, how I had my camps. It would only be like fight camp and then take a breather and then fight camp, where nowadays it's just like every day is training, you know. So there's no longer fight camps. It's just prepping for fights. I don't know, man. This lifestyle doesn't get old to me personally. I feel like you learn so much, so much that can relate to life outside of the gym, you know, that is going to be awesome to take with me later on in life. So I feel like I'm in it for the long haul, you know, body willing, if my body allows me, maybe another I'd like to range it like 8 to 10 years, you know, wow. 35, 37. Yeah. So we'll see, though. We'll see, God willing and body willing, what happens.
In the years in which you've done this, so now you know, it's 18 to 27 or 17 perhaps, even yep. to 27. Biggest lesson you've learned, not about life per se, the game of MMA, the sport, managing your affairs. I don't mean so much in the cage, yeah. but like how you progress. If you could talk to yourself at age 17, what would you say?
Don't put too much pressure on yourself, and just enjoy every single day. You know, there's times where I put so much pressure on myself early on in my career that it kind of, you know, brought me in dark places that I didn't really need to go to. But I am glad I went to those dark places, because it taught me that that lesson, you know, that I could take with me for the rest of my life. So just control what you can control and, you know, be happy.
Is Duke going to be in your corner?
100%. Yeah, he's been in my corner ever since I was just talking about that. I was watching my first kickboxing fight ever. I was 14 years old. He was in my corner. So this would be 13th year of
him
in my corner.
Bro, Duke is funny. So I worked with Duke briefly. So Duke and Morrow were the commentators for Glory right around 2014, and I was the roving reporter. I was fucking terrible in that job. I got
never
fired.
Never told that story.
Because I'm so
down.
Fucking terrible. I was so terrible at it, but they hired me anyway because whatever. But I remember talking to Duke, and Duke is funny, right? Because tell me if this is your experience, and obviously you know him significantly better. We'd be talking, and he would be like super friendly, all brotherhood, and then he would tell some story from training that sounded like the most fucked up, like hazing. Not that he would do it per se, but like, you know, dude, Duke's seen some shit in his time.
Oh, for sure.
And
man.
He has, it's amazing some of the stories that he's got from just a different universe of martial arts. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. He grew up in the sport. He's been through the, you know, the crazy times of Muay Thai and MMA, you know, boxing as well. So he's seen it all, man. And he's been through a lot.
Does he still train?
Yeah, he does. It's great. He still spar us. He'll still move. You know, I feel like he's a lifelong martial artist. You know, even if his body doesn't allow him to, I feel like he still will.
Does Duke ever, like, you know, put it on somebody at the gym?
No,
you know?
For sure. 100%.
Some white belt, he'll just go break his heart, break
no
his
white
leg.
Belts, yeah, no just, white belts. Yeah. But, yeah.
Do you still keep up with Phil Brooks, CM Punk?
Yeah, yeah. We talked to him a little bit on Instagram. He's at the gym once in a while, you know, he's doing his own thing now. But, yeah, he's still around.
We were taking...
Hey, the guy had balls, all right?
Hey, listen.
He had big balls.
Okay. I mean, definitely. You can comment on them. But we were taking bets. This dude you train with, pronounce his first name for me. Ralphion?
Yeah, Ralphion.
Ralphion.
Yep.
He's a beast, is he not?
For sure.
We were taking bets. He was like, do you think Rafael Stotts has put it on Phil Brooks if they've trained? And I'm like, I bet he put it on most people when he trains.
Yeah,
is that right?
100%. Raf's a killer, man.
How long have you been training with him?
I believe at least like 6 years now. Yeah, five or 6 years.
Oh, he's been there a while.
Yeah, he's been around for a while now.
Dude, there's a lot of dudes out there who are hovering just underneath the breakout surface.
Yep.
And I feel like he's one of those dudes.
100%. Yeah, Raf's, I believe with his performance this week, you guys are going to see a complete Rafion, you know, especially at the age he's at now, 232. He's been wrestling his whole life, and his MMA game has gotten ridiculously good in a quick amount of time. So, yeah, I think you guys will see that this Friday.
Friday's card, in which you're headlining, of course, against Archuleta, did take a certain level of a hit, heartbreaking hit, when Yoel Romero was out of the Rumble fight. Luckily, Rumble Johnson's still hanging on and going to fight Jose Augusto. Is there any part of you, though, that was not happy at the – because that brings more eyeballs to have those names on there. But, hey, man, maybe my fight can get the focus it deserves, you know, being up against those two big names.
Yeah, I feel like everything happens for a reason. You know, definitely would be awesome to get that. I don't wish anything. I honestly, I'm a fan of the sport. I wanted to see that fight, too. And I love Yoel Romero, too, and Anthony Johnson. So that would have been a hell of a fight, honestly. You know, I think everybody was down to see that fight. So definitely sucks, but it is what it is. And on to the next, you know. So let's see.
I still need to know what that would have looked like, okay?
What do you think it would have looked like?
A bloodbath, honestly, a bloodbath. Both of them are
killers. I can't decide if it would have been so, like Adesanya and Romero, where they were like so one of those.
I think it
would have
been slow and tense, but I think the explosive moments would have been amazing.
Explosions, yeah.
Who are the strikers out there, just as a fan? And it could be other sports, too. Like maybe it's Canelo, who's also fighting this weekend. Yep. Who are some strikers out there that you just really admire?
Lomachenko. I like his style. I like his angles. Gervonta Davis. A lot of boxers, honestly. Ryan Garcia.
Who wins that, Tank Davis or Garcia?
I don't know, man. That's a tough one.
I need to see that.
That's a tough one. I have a lot of Sanchai, Bolkow, Haggerty, Rod Sang. You know, I'm a big fan of all the sports, so most of them are a lot of stand-up strikers, but yeah.
Well, I can't wait to see what you got in store for us on Friday.
Thank
I know you've come
you.
A
Thank
long
you.
Way. You've earned this opportunity.
Appreciate
it's a big one. It's a tough one, but if anyone's up for the challenge, it's certainly you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I appreciate it.
You're ready. It's your time, all right?
Yes, sir.
Go get that belt.
Yeah.
Bring that belt home. Move those Wheaties boxes out of the way.
That's
okay,
right.
Let's get this.
Wherever they may be.
Yeah, wherever they're at.
There he is in the main event, fighting for the bantamweight title. It's Sergio Pettis.